Louis, the Mists will come back to Pyre. Let's continue our journey towards the Pit of Neliche, where we will encounter our next enemy. A groom hangs thick above the Pit of Neliche and all around it. You are brave to seek your adversaries here again, reader. Many in the downside believed it to be nothing other than a foul den. They take the tales of Ishlari, Astralbond, and mythology, embellished through recurring over time. You have met others such as Witch Oldmilde, who believes otherwise. Although, whichever their beliefs, I know of none who would go near the place unless the stars demanded it. Thus shall your coming right against the accusers take place in complete secrecy, as always the rites have. Falcon Woman may be passing through here with a special offer. Rookie spots are convenient landing here, where you should be able to pursue your vocations. Wolfert notes a powerful talisman is rumored to be buried on this path. You arrive again in the gloomy hollows of Lagging Hands, already anticipating the sinking feeling that comes with the place. This time, Gertrude has something to say for you. We shall show you how to withstand the less pleasant qualities of this locale. She reveals various salves and minor enchantments that help to counteract the spirit drain effects of the region. Soon, everyone is feeling better, if but for the assurances. Henceforth, you shall not suffer penalties to hope in this region. Flagging Hands. Beyond the valley lies the Flagging Hands, which could be called a swamp if an entire sea could merely be a lake. Soon after our arrival, several of us fell into a dark despair. Such were the environs. I found it rather fascinating, though. It held aspects reminiscent of the southern bogs we dwelt in as a tad. We grew accustomed to the dampness of the air and grew to savor certain greens and beetles. It can be said the Flagging Hands are an acquired taste, recommendable only for those of our same band, or perhaps the downside native imps. The sea surrounded the environs on three sides, appearing insurmountable at first. After having reached the gloomy halls of Plague Mound, you volunteer to survey the grounds. You prepare to head out. However, your companions beat you to it in this case.
Take a lot off, sister. Trudy and I got this one.
They depart, leaving you to rest up. When they later return with nothing much to report, you are feeling better and are in the midst of deciding which of your vocations to pursue. Sure thing, friend. Appreciate the offer. Where to begin? You illustrate to Hedwyn some of the intricacies of the rites, focusing on how all three in a triumvirate can move and act as one of one mind. You sense he grasps some of the concepts. No matter what anyone says, I refuse to think that there's some sort of limit to one's understanding of all this. Thank you for the lesson, my friend. It's given me a lot to think about. A messenger imp with news and rumors from the other side somehow tracks you down in the poisoned lands of Flagging Hands. The imp's message pertains to Fae, who you liberated at the fall of Soliam and whose past transgressions have all been forgiven since her return to the Commonwealth. You learned that she was taken in by a well-to-do foster family and was to be given private schooling of the highest order in the Astralis tradition. They promised her that, in time, she might one day have the honor of teaching the children of the Commonwealth herself. However, she soon went her own way, insisting that the eight scribes themselves were calling her. She started wandering again all on her own. That is until she vocated Wolfred's agents. Thus, her wandering ceased, and the ranks of the revolution grew stronger. Fae also felt a simple message. Believe in the scribes. You thank the messenger imp for the report as your companions gather to discuss. Tidzo misses having Fae around, though is pleased to hear that she is well.
You keep on doing those snotty commonwealth good-for-nothing, what's up, Fae?
Small in stature was the godly Fae, and great indeed in spirit. Even now this knight remains in awe of her.
Sounds like she's making a difference out there. I often felt she was the bravest of us all. She has the manner of a saint, that one. She knows in her heart the traditions of the scribes.
That one, very powerful indeed, a sorceress of sorts. A certain air about her, most intriguing.
News of Fae's liberation fills you and your fellow exiles with newfound resolve. Your companions gained hope for the next fight.
Bit of Meliethe. If there is one celestial landmark in which I would never again wish to thread, unless of course the stars besieged me to, it has to be the pit. It was dark in there beyond all reckoning. If not for Meliethe's sorcerer's lantern, all of us, we all would have been lost. What lies within the pit is not to be invoked, although I have no doubt our godly Underking shall be unable to prevent himself from boasting of how Meliethe sealed it there for an entire age. The thing yet lies there on the edge of death. Through its connection to the stars, it gives the pit significance. Walk there with courage and steady mind.
Hey guys, say, hey, whatever happened to that fae you brought in here sometimes, you know, the loopy one, fizzy hair, always handling all the merchandise. I liked her.
Flame Leech. After dosing adversaries power barrels, fire recovers.
Thanks for stopping by, guys!
As the sky above the pit of Meliethe darkens, your companions watch in silence and await the commencing of the rites. Her truth speaks up after a time.
The stars now burn for us!
Now everything is ready, and the stars begin to shine once more, precisely as foretold.
friends. You are returned once more unto the pit of Maleeth. The adversaries you are to confront shall be the accusers. Extinguish now their pyre, and glory shall be yours. Now prepare yourselves.
You. We are ready for you, Nightwings. Come, accusers, let's crush them and be done here quickly.
Go on, then. Rookie.
Tizo is fired up and ready to take on the accusers. Come on then, Nightwings, we are prepared for you.
Commence. All for naught. Nightwing's pyre burns brighter for now. That's it. With grace. Ta-ta, Lendo. Rookie plunged into their pyre. United in banishment. Shameful outcome. Somebody get the orb. Tizo takes the plunge.
No, not again. I cannot lose to you again. This can't be happening to me.
Yeah.
adversaries failed to stop them. Thus end this night's proceedings.
Blast! That a decorated constable of the Commonwealth should end up having to consort with fools as these, in these accursed robes and miserable circumstances. Those damn scribes certainly exist, for it is clear that they have no love for me or anyone of decent birth and station. But don't you all feel sorry for him though? After everything he's been through. Always a pleasure, Lando. After you secured victory over the accusers almost effortlessly, there is little time for you to rest as yet. The night beckons, and the next rite reveals itself to be a vital one. It is already time, reader. Come see for yourself. The coldness of this season now presents to us another chance. He heads out straight away and you follow in turn. Indeed, among the remaining stars you see one with which you are familiar now burns ever brightly. The path to freedom is laid bare before you. Already are the Nightwings summoned back to Mount Alodiel. Picture the ride as a wheel broken free from a black wagon. It is turning uncontrollably and soon shall reach a sudden stop. We should have several chances left for someone to go free, either us or else our adversaries, but not both. What is at stake each time is further complicated now, I must admit, knowing you have so few opportunities remaining. Those whom we send back into the Commonwealth, should our plan somehow fail, they may look back upon their exile with fondness. So, returning to the Commonwealth is not inherently a mercy, I don't think. Moreover, there are also those among us whom we count on to prevail in the rites. We need them on the Nightwings just as much as we need them in the Commonwealth. We cannot simply grow our numbers here given the circumstances. And so, who stays, who goes, these choices affect us all. No pressure there, my girl. Now, I don't know about you, but I shall go and take my leave for now. Let's set forth again at daybreak. You find Sir Gilmon searching intently for something or other, his eyes shut tight, his brow furrowed in deep concentration. He acknowledges your presence in the most minimal way possible and continues scanning the environment.
You shall have to forgive this knight's impertinence to you, Master Reader, for he is on the hunt at this time. Losing his acute sense of hearing, which is much more acute whilst underwater but shall have to suffice in this case, he shall track down a most elusive character. A character who has eluded this knight this time and time again, and from whom this knight seeks to learn still superior evasive strategies, applicable when next he may conduct the rites. Hold! Is that?
You have no idea to whom he is referring, Ren.
Stick that where you come out! Could have rung you like just now, you know?
Oh, this night has failed again. Alas, Master Rookie, once more you have outwitted this poor knight and outmaneuvered him. Please, you must reveal the secret to your speed and cunning.
Take it easy, John. You're not half bad yourself. Besides, I was getting pretty sick of running circles around all these slowpokes before you showed up while we were out at sea.
You truly mean that, Master Rookie?
But no, it can't be.
for this knight has never seen anyone as deft and fleet of foot as you. Certainly, it must be advantageous to possess 4 feet, whereas this knight has but one, if so it may be called, and yet we all are born with necessary means, and we must all make do.
And look, Jam, you got to stop being so hard on yourself already. You ever thought maybe you ought to give yourself a break once in a while?
Never! This knight deserves no break, not while there is a honor to be gained. He is merely a worm, one of roughly 8 billion of his kind. Thus, he must strive to be remarkable and to exceed what is expected of him.
Guess what, Jam? You went and did that already. I thought all you see the minion types were just a bunch of meathead who didn't care for nothing but a fight. But you've been downright decent. Even made me break a sweat a couple of times out there, when I thought maybe we got somebody quicker on his foot than me. Point I'm trying to make is, it's been good having you with us. I always say it's worth having someone quick around to keep you on our toes.
For a moment, he wonders if Sligman is about to weep. Sensing the same look, he immediately changes the subject.
Now, come on, you want to go another round or what? There's some good hiding spots outside where I can show you how we curse get to drop on unwary passers-by in a very honorable way.
This knight would be most honored, Master Ricky.
As the two of them head off to ford the train together, you catch notice of the Book of Rites there in the wagon, the Rites, which so stress trust and reliance on one's fellow exiles. The 8 scribes likely did not envision Sir Gilman and Ruki in particular as conductors of their sacred tradition, yet perhaps theirs is the sort of kinship which they had in mind. And that will be it for today. Thank you very much. Bye bye.